My name's Saviour Chinonso. I am born in Nigeria in a family of seven. I'm the first son, and we have two girls and five boys coming from my parents. And I stay here in South Africa, and the senior pastor of Christ Reconciliation Center in Edenville, Johannesburg, East South Africa. Last year, I lost my son, my only son, who was 4 years old. That happened 2 weeks after his birthday. And we just came back from church. I played with him. On that very day, he asked me to take a picture with him because we are wearing the same dress, white and red. And then he said that we were wearing the same clothes. Can we take a picture? And I said, okay, when we come back from church. And we had a very powerful service because we had a guest from Canada who came to preach. And after the preaching, we were supposed to go to Emperor's Palace with the guest minister, and then everybody was tired because we had a vigil previous Friday. So we decided to postpone the outing to Monday morning when the kids go to school so that we can go alone and have fun. But then I was so tired, and then we were in the lounge I like soccer, we're watching soccer with myself, with him, and my wife decided, okay, to go and prepare for the kids' school the following day in their room. And then while I was watching the soccer, I fell a bit asleep for maybe like 5 minutes. I dozed off because I was so tired, and then my son was with me, and then I don't know what happened. He left my presence and went to meet his two sisters. And the sisters decided they should go outside in the swimming pool area. And remember, I was dozed off, and my wife was in one of the rooms, busy preparing for their school uniform and all that. So shockingly, I heard their voice while I was sleeping. I heard their voice outside. So consciously, I just woke up. I said, I shouted their name. What are you people doing outside? Can you come inside? And then the sisters came inside, and I asked them, where is your brother? And they said they are looking for the brother. And I went back to sleeping because my wife has come out already, asking them, where is your brother? They said they are looking for their brother, and my wife began to search, call the name of the brother, Victory, where are you? Victory, where are you? And there was no response. So my wife came to me and said, sweetheart, they are looking for your boy. And I said, really? I just heard his voice not quite long calling the sister. So I jumped up from the couch and then rushed. My mind said to me, check the pool. And I looked from far, and I saw something that looked like an image of a person inside the pool. So I jumped in. I quickly looked for the spare remote, because that place can only be accessed by remote. I quickly looked for the spare and quickly jumped inside the pool and then got him out. He was still not dead. He was still breathing. But he vomited everything he ate on my body. And I started giving him this CPR, started pushing and all that to make sure the water goes out. And then we quickly rushed him to Edenville Hospital. And there was a mistake there. The doctors couldn't understand that this was emergency. They didn't take the baby immediately from our hands. So we kept shouting, please take this baby. And then they took almost 7 to 10 minutes before they could attend to the baby. And then before they could take the baby and go to the inside the emergency room, they just told me the baby's gone. I didn't believe it. And I said to them, my baby cannot go this way. I took him, I asked them, can they put oxygen? They looked for oxygen and put oxygen. And then gave me the child. I said, no, don't. They gave me something to write, like sign that the baby is gone. I said, it's not gone. not after a powerful service, not after a powerful Sunday, not after worshiping God and all that. It's not gone. So they said, no, the baby is gone. I said, okay, give me this baby. Let me go back to my church. I want to keep this baby in my altar and pray to God. God will bring this baby back. They refused. The doctor refused. He said, they can't do that. Before I could know it, they called police. Police came and said, no, you cannot take your baby out from this hospital. In fact, we're going to investigate you and know what happened to the baby. Then that was it. I said, okay, you know what? Give me time before you can package this baby and take to mortuary. Give me time. Let me pray. So me and my wife arrived at the hospital. I said, what happened? I said, the baby is gone. She said, no, he can't. Then we took the child to one corner of the hospital and prayed and worshipped and praised for 4 hours, like 4 or 5 hours. And then the baby could not come back to life. At a point, that was happening on February 24th of last year. At a point, my wife said, you know what? It's fine. Let the will of God be done. So we left our boy there. I kissed him, checked him. I couldn't let go, but I said, if God allowed it, what can I do? So I left the scene and they packaged the child and then we went home and informed the sisters what happened, that their brother has gone back to be with the Lord. They cried and everybody cried. It was so painful, like I was going crazy. I nearly had stroke. My wife could collapse from time to time. She could collapse and we would call ambulance. They would take her to hospital, and all that was happening there in, there out. Even my brother's wife also could not take it in because the boy was close to her as well. She would also collapse and they would take her to hospital. And that was happening at that period. It was so unbearable to everyone. As a man, as a pastor who preaches to people, who tells people to be strong when something like that happens, I tried my best to be strong. But sometimes I would go inside my room, break down, cry, and say, God, why? You would ask God why and why and why, and no response. And being a person who is also into prophetic, I have seen myself being used to deliver people of that kind of situation by prophetic words. If it's coming, I will tell them and all that. And a lot of things rose up. People began to ask, you're a prophet, why didn't you see that your child would die and all that? You know, when you face this type of thing, you go through some issues, some challenges, more tougher than what happened to you, coming from people around you who are saying a lot of things. People would say, you know, I think he used him for rituals. I think he used him for power. I know these things do happen. But when you are innocent of these things, it hurts double. And then people will tell you, and when you see that, you remember what God have used you to do in the life of these people, that you hear that they're saying this and that and that and that. It breaks you the more. Knowing that you are so innocent, it breaks you the more. And sometimes I will say to people, I wish you know how close I am with this guy. I was with this guy. This guy is a photo. People call him a photocopy of me. My wife calls him my twins. Even the day he passed, my wife said, your twin has gone. We are like this. We go everywhere together. That was why even when he died, I found it so difficult for like 2-3 months to go out, because I always go out with him. So everywhere I go, people in the shops, they know that this guy is always with me. They'll ask you, where is your boy? This one you're alone, where is your boy? This one you're walking, where is your boy? Where is your boy? Where is your boy? So the question was too much on me. So for months, I stayed indoors. I didn't go out. I was always crying on a daily basis. I even nearly lost my ministry because I lost interest in pushing again. But funny thing was, anytime I come to preach in the altar, there's a strange strength that comes to me that makes me forget what I'm going through, and I'll preach and I'll deliver people through the help of the Holy Spirit, and I'll do all those things. But then after the service, I would go back in crying. But when I come in there, at the point, I remember telling my driver, I said, you know what? It looks like God is just making use of me. How can he take me out of my house on Sundays to church? And if he feels like everything is okay, I will preach, people will get delivered, people will get their healings. And then the moment I come back here, the pain returns. And they were just telling me, just keep it there, keep holding it there. They booked me for counseling. I went for counselings and all that. But before the counseling, I already told myself that this counseling will not work for me. These are the things I do for people. What are they going to tell me? I don't know. That's what I said. So, my guess was right. When they took me to the stage 1, 2, 3, 4, whatever counseling, it was not really getting to me. I was not having any impact from it. Rather, I was having encouragement from the word of the Lord that God said, everything happens for a reason. Everything happens for a purpose. And if God is with us, no one can be against us. So if God allowed it, definitely it's his will. He has a reason and a purpose. So that made me not to panic or fear. I allowed myself to go through the healing gradually and I overcame it. It's not really, really gone, but now I can tell you I don't cry anymore. Now I can tell you I'm fine. Now I can tell you I've accepted it. Now I can tell you that I know that my son is with the Lord. So if you are going through such situation in life, what I would tell you is this. Through it all, I understood that no one method works for everybody. Yours might be going to counseling. Yours might be going to speak to people who you trust. Yours might be going to speak to your pastor. You might find comfort in his pictures or in your child's picture. You might find comfort in their clothing. Like, I remember my wife would always find comfort with watching his pictures and his videos. Whenever she watches them, she starts laughing and then she feels fine. But me, each time I see the videos or the pictures, I get broken. So she doesn't allow me to be there whenever she's watching them or looking at them. Even my daughters, whenever they are watching the pictures, they are fine. But me, particularly, whenever I see the pictures or the videos, I break down. So they only watch it secretly. I remember my wife breaking my son's phone. My son had a phone, a tablet. I remember my wife broke it because he had a lot of videos he recorded there. So whenever my daughters would play the videos, whenever I hear his cries or his smiles or his laugh or his talking, I start crying. So my wife broke the phone and said, no, this is not good for you, for anybody in this house. Keep it. Since your father is not feeling okay with it, make sure you don't play it again. So I will tell you, anywhere you can find comfort, anything that works for you, follow it. Don't say because Mr. A used counseling and it worked for Mr. A that it will work for you. It might not work for you like it didn't work for me. Don't say that your own might be people coming around you. It might not work for you. Sometimes you want to be alone. So whatever that you feel that worked for you, go for it. Just go for it. Don't wait for people to tell you this is how the other person went through it. This is how the other person went through it. It's all about you. You trying some methods, whichever one that is working for you, just stick to it. And I promise you, as time goes by, you'll be healed. Time heals. Time heals this situation. The only thing that can heal you is time. When it happens to you, you feel like my world is done. I cannot survive again. I cannot live again. I don't think I am able to bear this. But remember this, if God allowed it to come to you, he already knew that you would go through it and come out alive. My name is Saviour Chinonso Amechi, and I've been through the most.